座って、Good evening. I was asked to say a few words in the beginning. I just want to say that we as an orchestra were very impressed by this beautiful audience which we found here in your festival, that this hall is a very special place, a very beautiful hall for music making, and that we did enjoy it very much to play one of our performances of this piece here in the Enescu Festival. Enescu as a musician does mean a lot to me. He did not write any music for the little chamber orchestra which we have here, but I hope we could bring you together with this beautiful theater piece, we could bring you some music from our native Austria to Romania. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So now we open our very short press conference. You have just heard the words, the kind words of Mr. Martin Haselberg, the conductor of Wiener Academy, Mr. John Markovic, and we also have here Mr. Michael Stuminger, the writer and director of this show. Would you like to say a few words, Mr. Markovic, or just switch directly to questions? Okay, so we will start with a question from TV.
Hello, I'm a professor. Any way from all other shows in the tour?
Well, all performances are different because theater is a living, ephemeral organism. So I've done the opera with 24, 26 singers. So every one of them is different, and their interpretations are different. And of course, all publics are different. So this was a lovely show and a terrific audience.
Was it a good vibe from the audience?
Yeah, very much so.
Any other questions? May I ask you to
repeat
the question?
I know that your character doesn't like the opera, but do you like the opera?
Yeah, I love the music in this piece and in the other piece the three of us do together, which we just finished filming in Lisbon last week. And I think this music is so powerful, both the orchestral ones and the arias are, I think, fantastically powerful. And I think Miguel and Martin did an excellent job in making it compact in terms of text and interesting and having fantastic music, which I think fits the piece very well.
Did you improvise something in this show? And how did you work with an orchestra with fixed rules? You, as an actor, you are free, you are... How did you manage to work?
You know, many people in the orchestra and many of the singers have often said the way I act affects the way they play. But the way they play and sing affects the way they act. So, this kind of music, you can't, you have to find ways to slide around. The music can't really be confronted by an actor. It's not really possible. You have to slide around it, and I found that a great challenge and a great delight, really.
What is your opinion about Jack Unterweger?
Well, Jack Unterweger is a type of person who enjoys and becomes excited by the pain and terror he causes. So I don't think much about him, or let's say I don't think much of him.
Do you think any of the people who supported him have any remorse afterward?
I would imagine, but I don't know any of them personally, so. But I would imagine they did. You would hope they did, but.
How is it for you as an actor to play always the psycho? It's kind of a speciality for you.
Well, I do lots of things, really. We just finished the Casanova film. I'm not sure if he was a psycho. And I don't really think of characters like that. A character is defined in his worldview within the actions of a play. And I think this piece was very interestingly recreated the experience the Austrian public had when they met Unterweger, that he was charming and funny, and I mean,
yes, you are.
He wasn't a very good writer, but that's okay. He was charming and funny, you know. The other night I had dinner with our costumer at Café Handel in Vienna. And I remember several of the waiters coming up over the years. We've been doing this in our other piece and in and out of Vienna. And all saying, you know, he was very nice. Yeah. Maybe sometimes he is, I don't know.
One last question from the media.
From your start from your first acting experience at the Steppenwolf Theatre till now, what main things do you feel have changed in you, and what has remained the same?
I don't think anything really changed in me, except I stayed open and curious about the world, and that has led me to experiences that, say, some of my friends or colleagues may not understand why I'm doing them, but that's how you keep growing and keep fresh. I don't know if I could have done this when I was very, very young, maybe, but everything you do is obviously an accumulation of your experiences, so the more you have and the more you have the opportunity to have, and the more you take that opportunity, I think the better it is for you.
Can I ask you very kindly to accept also a question from the moderator? Because this is the last performance, as far as I have understood. Maybe you can tell us a few words about this fact that this is the last performance, why it is, and what do you plan next, if you have some plans to share with us?
Well, we'll see, but as of now, I really need time off. I've done this opera for 5 years, our other one for 2.5 years. Traveling the world, if you're a known face, is more or less a nightmare. Because now that we're all paparazzi, I probably do that 500 times a day, or 1,000, and they don't care what you're doing. When Mickey and I would leave the theater in Lisbon to talk, have a cigarette and talk 2 minutes about what we were doing or what we were going to do or what we should do or what we might do, you just have to stop for photographs. Photo, 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 photo. It's insanely rude and unbelievably invasive, but we're all paparazzi now. And people often say to me, well, you're famous. Well, so what? I mean, do you think I can smoke a cigarette or make a phone call or study my text or have a life? No, because I have to have a photo. Okay, well, there are like 6 billion of you. And that's actually one of the biggest problems of doing this, is traveling all the time, being in airports, being tortured. I wouldn't ask anybody for a photo. I mean, to me, it's if I said, lift your dress. Sure, why not? I mean, I may want that. Great. But wouldn't you find it odd? I mean, it's very odd. But, you know, we'll see. On the other hand, I have Steppenwolf wants me to act in a play. I have a movie to direct. And, you know, I've done this 5 years. I mean, really 4 years. And really, the last 3 years have been fairly often. And, you know, it's a beautiful piece. And we've often talked about, and I've urged them to find another actor or other actors, because I'm the only one who has to be here all the time. And if a singer gets sick or has another gig or shoots her husband or something, we get another one. But I have to be there all the time, and my movie career or my producing movie career or my theater career are not planned such a long time in advance. And it's nothing to do with the piece. I love the piece. I've done it and loved it and defended it when I had to for years. I think it's a super interesting piece.
I have one more question for both of you, actually. How is it to write a piece for John Malkovich, and how is it for you to know that that piece was written for you? And that piece has such a success?
In the case of this piece, I just knew John from one conversation of an hour when I wrote this, and I just took my chance. I just wrote it, and I imagined what would I do if I was on the stage and have to and know there is an orchestra and there is 2 sopranos, that is what we knew, and what could be possible. So I just sat there and imagined what I would do if I was John Malkovich, and what would I say if I was supposed to kind of interpret the life of this Jack Unterweger. But it was a very like down-to-earth thing. It was just say, take the chance, try to imagine what you would do if you had the possibility of standing there and being that, and what and trying to get away with it. And I didn't know if John would, I mean, I knew he was going to read it, and I knew he was interested, so I thought this was a fantastic chance. And so I wrote it, and John read it and said, why not? Sounds interesting, and then he gave it a try. it was in a way quite simple. And I, the other thing is that, I mean, everyone, if you work on a field where you have your heroes and everyone has his heroes, and John has the disadvantage and the advantage of being a hero of many, many people that love cinema or theater, then of course you have kind of fantasies which are very stupid. And if you're aware that every person is still the person, you can probably find out that your hero as a person is even interesting without the hero part. And if you get to that point, this is a great gift. And I can say that after like this 5-year story, the three of us have become friends. And that is maybe the most beautiful gift of all that, and I'm very grateful.
Thank you so much. Would you like to take some more questions?
One.
Social press. Okay.
John, from your perspective, since you already shared with us what is the worst part of being John Malkovich or being famous, would you only feel like tell us what is the best part of being John Malkovich, or person?
The best part is getting the opportunity to work with people like Martin and Mickey, the orchestra, all of our wonderful collaborators, which you see, if you weren't famous, you wouldn't get that chance. And it's not because you wouldn't be good enough or be interested, it's just kind of how the way the world works. And that has given me, as I said, what some people find are odd choices, why are we in Gunterslow with him doing an opera, you know? And I just said because I felt like it.
It's too much of an honor for us too, but I just can add that for me, I think this is one more experience that true art is always a dialogue. And I think it's impossible for us to sit down in our little chamber and create something all by ourselves. I have experienced this in my artistic life. I've always tried to cooperate with poets, with painters, with people who do art, but in another field as mine. And maybe this is the coronation of this cooperation, because we feel the result is something where everybody is giving in and giving in from his own side. And maybe the surprise is that it works, that three different people give in and many people who cooperate give in. And for me, this is a maybe almost a symbol for a true artistic achievement to include different sources from totally different sides.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Hassel, I just spoke with Laura Aiken downstairs, and she told me that John is improvising a lot when they're changing a little bit, sometimes for his position on the stage,
yeah.
So kind of provoking them to react to that, and you have also to follow them while they react to John's little, how is it?
Yeah, but for me it's normal, because conductors always have to react to what comes, and I think if we say improvisation, it's always this freshness of performance. Maybe I have to make clear that the text is with the exception of two parts, which kind of are left free, is what the text is always the same, but the performance is always different, because then it's always new and fresh. And this is the same with music, otherwise we would not survive to play the same pieces by Bach, Mozart and Beethoven. And maybe to quote, this is the sign of true art, is that you do a piece many times and you discover always new aspects in the piece, and this is true for all classical music of some quality, I would say.
It's even the funny thing that I saw this the first time in South America when we were touring, but it's really funny that you have always a translation up or on the sides. We always have a translation for John in the countries which is not English speaking, and still the people think, and a lot of people think that the whole text is made up in a minute. Although they read it all the time, there must be a very quick version of translating. And that would be really genius. But still, the idea is with this piece, we fake as if it wasn't rehearsed, we fake as if it was made up in a minute, and that of course gives it this kind of atmosphere. But the other thing is, and that's maybe one great part of John's art, that he wouldn't go and like perform something in a way he did it before. So the general thing, and this is something which great musicians will always do, and great actors and great performers, it's say there's you always get a certain kind of intensity only if you grasp what is coming and have room for it. So if the concept is so close that you can't react to what is coming, you cannot make it grow. And this is maybe the great difference to cinema, that a piece of theater and a piece of music, like the film, will always, if it's good, always respond to what is happening in the moment. And of course, this is something John is very aware and was working on his whole life. And even in cinema, and I can tell you now, because we have been shooting together this film the last 6 weeks, the fantastic thing is even in cinema, you can keep it open and you will find out that every take is different and every moment gives the possibility to do something else. And maybe John is one of the best people in the world to take this liberty and like theoretically have the momentum to say anything could happen in any moment. And this is something which gives a great, great, great tension and great liveliness to all performances. And I think this is what we maybe know in a way, but still learn from this work in another way, how far you can go in this field. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No flowers, I understand. Oh, but you make an exception. Oh, it's an honor. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.